Yes, this is my video on the entire official James Bond series. Now, as you're probably aware, No Time to Die is now coming out in November. But as I had already started work on this video, I decided to release it now. So, let's get to ranking every Eon James Bond film up to No Time to Die. So this wasn't easy. As I've said before, I'm not a fan of ranking films. I've made one ranking video in 5 years, until now. So, why attempt to rank Bond? Well, No Time to Die is coming in November now, and of course, as a British kid who grew up with yearly Bond marathons on TV, I've often had the which is the best Bond debate. It just feels right to do it for this channel. The character for me, as I've spoken about before, is a strange one. I grew up with Bond from before I can remember. My very favourite Bond actor and film has changed multiple times as I've grown older, along with my general feelings toward Ian Fleming's creation. As I've grown to understand British and cinematic history and seen certain societal and political norms shift and change, along with my own social beliefs develop, I've fallen in and a little bit out of love sometimes with the idea of James Bond and the film series the character spawned.
I think you're a sexist, misogynist dinosaur, a relic of the Cold War.
I'm not here at all to disregard the character. In fact, Bond has been a very important and arguably integral part of film history.
And you've had your six.
I am going to look at this series relatively broadly. Frankly, with 24 official films, my usual franchise deep dive would make this video about 2 hours long, and as much as I'd love to do that, I just don't have the time. This is instead an overview of the highs and the lows, seen both objectively from the perspective of me watching these all at the same time, and subjectively to what they set out to achieve when they were released. It is a mammoth task, really. You aren't going to agree with me 100%. You'll probably disagree with me more than you agree with me, and that's okay. This is my ranking, and I'd love to hear why you think I'm wrong and maybe put some rankings below, see which ones get the most likes, which the most people agree with. It'll be interesting.
My God, what's Bond doing?
I think he's attempting re-entry, sir.
Now, of course, one thing I am sure James Bond would appreciate is technology like a VPN. With cybersecurity so important these days and the ability, of course, to see the content you want free of region restrictions, such as UK viewers being able to see the Brosnan Bonds via US Netflix, then you cannot go wrong with Surfshark. It is an incredibly easy to use and intuitive service, and for a limited time you can get 83% off a 2-year plan and an additional month for free at surfshark.deals/rossatron with the code Rossatron. This special offer makes your subscription just $1.91 per month, so you can browse securely on up to 6 devices. So, let's start at the bottom and work our way to the top. Which is my least favourite of the whole Bond series? This one. The phrase to best explain Octopussy would be tongue-in-cheek. Which, for Moore's usually lighter Bond, would seem to make sense. That said, the tone here feels so off the mark, in a plot that feels kinda carelessly put together, with a villain who simply makes little impact, that it's hard to justify telling someone to sit through it again.
Really, 007.
Tone is integral to a successful Bond film, with the creators always walking a line between general entertainment and still making something that's tensely gripping, and balancing moments of levity with body counts and sometimes end-of-the-world scenarios. Dip too far into silly, you better hope that your whole film supports that and does it well. But remain too dark and gritty, you're gonna need to ensure there's a wink here and there to remind us that this is Bond.
They'll print anything these days.
Octopussy, for me, completely fluffed that tone, never quite finding a spine to pull everything together as well into something that feels cohesive. If in trying so hard to be fun actively makes your film less fun, then sadly, I have to call it a failure.
I'm deadly serious! I'm a British agent!
What?
Which isn't to say something as perhaps middle of the road as A View to a Kill isn't a near failure too. Though I do have a soft spot for Walken's villain, which may be more my own warmth toward the actor than the writing, this is really just a rather dull affair. and that is truly the death knell for a Bond film.
I would have to be
dead.
It's all staged without any real flair, and the clearly too old Moore,
brilliant,
just feels wrong for the part at this point. Honestly, before rewatching, I remembered it most for Grace Jones, and it being the film that, in a way, briefly introduced Dolph Lundgren to the world. Oh, and the song is admittedly a banger. Whatever people say, and open the gates for a variety of different takes on Bond themes from then on. If anything, this film could have been at the bottom of the list, but I could never put Duran Duran's theme lower than All Time High. That's just personal preference. Don't worry that two Moore films are so low, by the way. I definitely like Moore as Bond, but he did inhabit the character at a time when the series was really trying to find its place amongst the developing action genre it had helped inspire. And it led to a lot of questionable creative decisions and drastic quality differences between films.
Well, he certainly left with his tails between his legs.
Now, a campy tone doesn't overwhelm Diamonds Are Forever, which comes with Sean Connery's final official performance and a great Shirley Bassey theme, but it does have some of the worst villains of the series.
Good evening, 007.
The action is definitely well handled, as one would expect from Goldfinger director Guy Hamilton, but this is certainly the most forgettable effort starring the original Bond. A note here, of course, on the villains of Bond. If Bond is a dependable hero and always well performed by a variety of great actors, then it is each film's villain that is surely one of the most integral elements to define success or failure. Bond represents that hero of Queen and Country, ultimately incorruptible.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die.
The best villains represent a mirror to that. Corrupt, twisted, sometimes a complete opposite of Bond, sometimes a vision of what Bond could be if he turned to darkness. The worst villains show little of this, feeling like they could appear as a villain in any action film, any crime story. Diamond R Forever's Mr. Wint and Mr. Kidd encapsulate this, for example, being simply quipping assassins.
I must say, Miss Kay seems quite attractive. For a lady.
And this is probably going to rub some people the wrong way, but it takes me to Quantum of Solace, and Matthew Amalric's Dominic Green. Whom, for whilst I can see what they were attempting, comes off as a screeching presence that is more grating for the audience than he is for Bond. He's indicative of a lot of the issues I have with Quantum, which is that as a direct sequel to Casino Royale, a wonderful action film brilliantly executed with a fantastic villain, it suffers as a follow-up at every turn.
How much do you know about Bond, Camille? Because he's rather a tragic case.
It is mercifully the shortest Bond film yet, but the action is hard to follow, representing the worst of post-Bourne action production. The revenge plot does less to develop Bond's character than the previous film's semi-origin did, and as good as Olga Kurylenko is, she makes far less impact than Evergreen's redefining of what a Bond girl can be. Now, a villain that not only stands out in his film, but perhaps saves it, is Scaramanga. Played with almost iconic verve and a third nipple by Christopher Lee, he provides a fitting foil for Moore's rarely seen toned-down Bond. Now, this isn't a great film, but over the years I've come to enjoy it more. The final showdown between Moore and Lee impresses in the context of the series, and the exotic locales and Mary Goodnight's clumsy agent give a lot to look at.
You're not thinking that.
I sure am, boy.
Never heard of Evel Knievel.
It is evidence that regardless of how the rest of it works, with a good Bond and a great villain, there's nothing quite like a 007 film, even when it may be a decidedly average entry for the series.
This is the part I really like.
I will admit a certain bias in that when Bond goes really silly, it is harder for it to work for me. Especially in a post-Austin Powers world, when things get overly camp and borderline spoofy, I get a little more critical. Self-awareness is crucial to the series, but with something like Moonraker, I have to of course see it for what it is. Now I won't say that it falls quite as flat for me as, say, Octopussy, as this film at least feels like it goes all in on something that as a 70s curio is undeniably entertaining at times. There is a certain charm in its rough attempts at comedy, and honestly, some of it lands.
I am looking for Dr. Goodhead.
You just found her.
A woman?
Your powers of observation do you credit, Mr. Bond?
I'd certainly rather rewatch it than something that feels as cynically put together as A View to a Kill. And here's another one that's gonna probably piss some people off. Sometimes you get a bad villain,
cuckoo,
but a great henchman. Like, for example, Batista in Spectre. Whereas the Blofeld reveal felt to me forced into a story that didn't require it,
finish it.
Hinks pleasingly reminded me of Robert Shaw's Red Grant in one of the best fights of the series. I'm not 100% sure why he was trying to kill Bond. There are arguments either way, but he is magnetic in the role. The rest of the film is sadly let down though by a needlessly convoluted plot and Lea Seydoux wasted in a role that gives her little chance to build toward the unsatisfying I love you moment. Following the spectacular Skyfall, this needed to do better, and strong action cannot save this overlong, overstuffed effort. And come on, Sam Smith's theme is one of the series' worst yet. Well, I'm not sure it's worse than this. Is Die Another Day deserving of being relatively high on the list to what people probably expect? Well, not only would it seem a bit of a cliche to put Brosnan's last effort at the bottom, but honestly, rewatching it now in the context of the whole series, it's really not that bad. It derails toward the end, but it leans into its silliness in a way that gels with the film rather than feeling at odds with it, such as with Octopussy. Yes, the CGI leaves something to be desired, but there isn't actually all that much of it, and the practical work is excellent.
You might mention it, 007, but a perfect marksman isn't really supposed to shoot his own boss.
I also quite like Halle Berry as Jinx and her chemistry with Brosnan. Perhaps the film lacks some of the charm of older efforts, and definitely the grit of Brosnan's best work in the role, but I'll be damned if returning to it, I wasn't surprised by at least how watchable it was. I feel like I remembered it being worse due to how much people deride it, rather than my own experience with the film. Thunderball next, and why so low? Well, honestly, this is one where objectively it falls down. Perhaps at the time it worked better, of course, and I understand seeing the films for what they were trying to achieve is important. That said, this follows some of the most classic of Bond, and compared to those, it kind of just drags. Much has been written about its underwater scenes and how they overstay their welcome. Critics found it somewhat disappointing in 1965, and time hasn't been kinder.
I'm glad I killed him.
You're glad?
Filthy habit.
Now you might be surprised to see Tomorrow Never Dies here, as typically it is not one that gets much love. This one, pleasingly, at least does get things done in just less than 2 hours. Relevance though is important here too, as Tomorrow Never Dies is not only a serviceable action film that maintains a good balance of fun and suspense, but its villainous plot does feel far more prescient now than it did perhaps in 1997. Coupled with a Bond girl who could handle herself more than most seen thus far, played with Michelle Yeoh's usually magnetic presence, it feels ahead of the time. It certainly isn't as good as GoldenEye, but it stands out to me more now than in 97. It's still pretty by the numbers, but better than its legacy or lack thereof may have you believe.
Pop the clutch.
Oh, by the way, we haven't been properly introduced, Molina. My name is Bond.
James Bond.
That feeling of functional, if not particularly memorable, continues into my next entry in the list, For Your Eyes Only. The debut of director John Glenn, who would go on to helm perhaps one of the less popular eras of Bond films, this is Bond more in line with Connery and Dalton than most Moore efforts. It's a pared-down, perhaps grittier attempt, something Glenn would in my opinion refine with his work on The Living Daylights and License to Kill. Its stunt work stands out, however, something that defined the series increasingly as it grew, creating unforgettable moments that even in the age of CGI would still be a staple of the series. The stunts of Bond really have remained not only integral, but successful, regardless of the quality of the films around them. From the very beginning to the most recent entry, Bond has continually pushed the limit in the West of what could be achieved practically by stunt performers. Though as said, Bond always felt creatively functional in a substance over style sort of way. These grandstanding moments allowed for each film's creative team to use their imagination and allow stunt units to prove their talents to the world. One such stunt that I have always remembered for its daring is the crocodile run in Live and Let Die. Coupled with the then record-breaking speedboat jump, the first Roger Moore entry really set a new expectation stunt-wise for what audiences could expect from a Bond film. It is one of the better Moore films and is helped by Jane Seymour's Solitaire, who impresses as one of the best Bond girls, or at least is amongst my favourites.
Jin.
Oh, James.
And talking Bond girls, one can't really discuss my next in the list without mentioning Ursula Andress, whose Honey Rider would become instantly iconic.
Do you have a woman of your own?
Or at least the image of her exiting the sea in a white bikini would. See now, Dr. No is a lean and yet still somewhat slow film, but was so instantly packed with elements that would become key to the series that it has to be admired.
You never take me to dinner looking like this, James.
From Connery's pitch-perfect introduction.
I admire your luck, Mr.
Bond. James Bond.
To the vibrant locales. It wouldn't define the series perhaps as much structurally as Goldfinger, but it certainly laid the groundwork surprisingly well. That theme, of course, would be what really stood the test of time. Being reused and remixed to this day, and instantly recognisable to pretty much anyone that hears it, regardless of whether they've actually seen a Bond film. The music of Bond, from the themes to the underlying scores, are integral to the continued success of the series. Bond grows with the times, and yet maintains that thematic resonance with the original character. The Bond themes, to me, are less successful when they become too desperate to be hit songs, more in line with the artist singing them than the character, whilst the best ones evoke a fresh atmosphere, indicative of the film being recognisably Bond. It's hard to put into words what really makes a great Bond theme, or even score for that matter. You have to feel it. You have to hear it over speakers in a cinema as the visuals play in front of you. It's a holdover from the days of overtures. It can't be limp, but it can't be overbearing. It has to say something about the character, about the villain, without beating you over the head with detail. It's an announcement, a scene setting, an arousing reminder that this is a motherfucking Bond film. And Barry's last score for Bond was for my next film on the list, The Living Daylights. Music would be of particular importance to the film, as the Bond girl this time is Cara Milvoy, a celloist. We hear classical music played here and there, and even see Barry as a composer toward the end of the film.
You didn't think I'd miss this performance, did you?
Much debate appeared around Dalton's portrayal of 007 that has continued to this day, with some lamenting his overly serious take in what is a more lean, violent affair. I'm amongst those who not only appreciate what he did with the character, but also feels the two films he starred in are supremely underrated. Following Moore's overlong hold on the character that often fell into camp to sometimes disappointing results, the Dalton films work as spy thrillers on their own, outside of the Bond framework, while still feeling what Ian Fleming had in mind for the character. Perhaps at the time they were felt to be somewhat humorless, but if you watch The Living Daylights now close to the Moore run, it is honestly a breath of fresh air. Relatively uncomplicated in plot and tone, it wouldn't perhaps stand out as much as a divisive License to Kill, but it showed that Bond could still be relevant without being overly self-aware. The world is not enough this high? Huh? With 52% on Rotten Tomatoes? Well, yes. Honestly, I really like much of Brosnan's era, if that's not clear. And from the weirdly small-scale opening that takes us quickly back to MI6, only to surprise, turn into a fantastic speedboat chase through London, followed by Garbage's catchy, grungy theme, this instantly hooks you in. Honestly, even Denise Richards, by far the weakest part of the film, didn't bother me so much. And Sophie Marceau is so good as Electra King, she makes up for it anyway.
You should have killed me when you had the chance.
There is smart work here. It instantly connects M to the plot in a believable way.
After Electra King was kidnapped, her father tried to deal with it on his own, with no success. So he came to me.
It injures Bond early on to add tension to the narrative. The antagonist, even if his ability to get stronger as he gets closer to death is underused, has a more grounded, believable villainous plot and a surprisingly human depth to his character.
Are you really gonna commit suicide for her?
You forget. I'm already dead.
Haven't you heard?
So is she.
Yes, it perhaps isn't the most inventive of stories for the series, but it does what it does very well, and is filled with fantastic stunt work, some great writing, and is genuinely thrilling. It deserves reappraisal.
Hello, Base One.
Listening.
Little Nelly got a hot reception. 4 big shots made improper advances towards her, but she defended her honor with great success.
I struggled with whether I liked You Only Live Twice more or less than The World Is Not Enough, but in the end I couldn't help but admire the lavish production design and pure 60s-ness of it, edging it just ahead of that admittedly less iconic film.
Allow me to introduce myself. I am Ernst Stavro Blofeld.
You Only Live Twice feels a bit ridiculous, but it works in a way that, say, Moonraker doesn't. Donald Pleasance is of course fantastic as Blofeld, and fits the vibe of the film perfectly.
Goodbye, Mr. Bond.
It certainly feels a world away from License to Kill, which to this day remains one of the more divisive films in the series. It was one of the least successful financially, and almost buried the franchise until GoldenEye 6 years later. It's also, for my money, and I imagine many will disagree with me here, one of the most underrated films in a whole series and deserving of the gradual reappraisal it has started to get. Feeling arguably more in line with Fleming's harder vision for Bond long before Daniel Craig put on the tuxedo, and certainly one of the most graphic of the franchise, License to Kill is effective as an isolated mature thriller, whilst also being one of the few films since On Her Majesty's Secret Service to really look at who Bond is as a person and delve into his character.
Did I see something wrong?
He was married once, but it was a long time ago.
Not only that, but it's also full of impressive action and excellent stunt work. Had it not been a Bond film, but instead a dark, original, introspective hero story to close out the decade, I imagine its legacy could perhaps have been more positive.
Are you all right?
Switch the bloody machine off!
It's not going to be a surprise to anyone when I bring up that the treatment of women throughout the series has been at best questionable. But I'm not going to preach here about objectification or anything like that. I do think to look at Bond now and criticise its women characters, you do have to see it as a series of its time. admittedly saying this as a man and definitely aware that I'm not the person to decide what was right and wrong when it comes to gender and Bond. I'm not going to, for example, criticise Goldfinger as much as Skyfall, as the former came out in the 60s, whilst Bond sneaking uninvited into the shower of a sexual slavery survivor in the latter.
So were you 12? 13?
Made me uneasy in the cinema, and still does now, regardless of how good the rest of that film might be.
It's the part I like.
All of that aside, the Bond girl is an integral part of the series. And some certainly work better than others. The best ones had a strength of their own, and a sense of humour to match Bond's. They felt alive, with or without James Bond, and not simply, to use a charged phrase, objects. It was the performances which shone through the often underwritten roles that had impact, though the very best were purposely written to be almost as important to the plot as Bond himself. Sometimes too, they of course made excellent villains, with one in particular really standing out to me. Famke Janssen is surely one of the more memorable parts of an already great Bond film that perhaps some will be surprised I haven't placed higher. Frankly, from here onward, we are in the gold standard of the 007 series, and working out the placement of what follows has been quite the challenge. The wonderfully named Xenia Onatopp, a crazed femme fatale who seems to desire Bond as much as wanted to kill him, stands out as one of the best hench people of the series.
You think you can break me?
That we also get Sean Bean as a 00 agent gone bad, in a tense plot that allows for some brilliant action-packed set pieces, helped rejuvenate the series and brought it roaring into the 90s, when action cinema was certainly in a time of change. As with much of this final section of the list, I really struggled with where to place Skyfall.
He's keen to get home.
Upon first seeing it, save for the aforementioned unfortunate handling of Berenice Marlowe's Severin, I fell for Skyfall. It is undoubtedly the most beautiful of the whole franchise, with Sam Mendes and Roger Deakins doing a lot to pull Bond back from out of the Bourne series' shadow.
I read your obituary of me.
And?
Appalling.
I loved as well how it delved into the origin of Bond, and its falling back onto a particularly lo-fi end conflict that gave Judi Dench the time and respect she deserved.
I suppose it's too late to make a run for it.
Skyfall, like On Her Majesty's Secret Service, Casino Royale, and various other moments throughout the series, served to humanize this at times inhumane character. It aimed higher than most, and brushed with true greatness. So why is From Russia With Love placed higher? I'm taken into account when it first released, but also that it is a now refreshingly lean and mean thriller, pre-Goldfinger structure and iconography affirmation that carries an air of danger through its excellent screenplay.
Suppose when she meets me in the flesh, I don't come up to expectations.
Just see what you do.
With terrifyingly to-the-point villains, and a fight with Robert Shaw that would provide the kindling for Spectre's excellent train scene, this is Sean Connery's Bond mainly using grit and determination over gadgetry and gimmicks, and I am always down for that. Casino Royale definitely took some inspiration from that concept. Martin Campbell once again was tasked with bringing the series back into favour, the way he had with GoldenEye.
I'm sorry. That last hand nearly killed me.
Using Ian Fleming's writing of Bond as cold and calculated, embodied by a terrific Daniel Craig, he delivered a reminder that a 007 film can not only stand out within contemporary action cinema, but help redefine it. The villainous Le Chiffre, who after the over-the-top comic book silliness of Die Another Day, offered a pleasingly down-to-earth, realistic opponent for Bond physically and mentally.
No! To the right!
Vespa Lind, on the other hand, represented real desire, a level of love I hadn't seen in Bond since On Her Majesty's Secret Service.
It wouldn't be a stretch to imagine. You think of women as disposable pleasures rather than meaningful pursuits.
It perhaps becomes a little convoluted too quickly by the end, but that is barely a criticism, and honestly, this film has lost none of its power, and easily places amongst the best of recent action output, not just the Bond series.
The name's Bond. James Bond.
And that brings me to the top three. The Spy Who Loved Me is a James Bond series at its best.
But James, I need you.
So does England.
If Goldfinger really laid the framework of what a 007 film would become, this is that framework at its proven best. With Lewis Gilbert learning from his time directing You Only Live Twice to bring real style to this, Ken Adams' never better production design supporting it all, and of course John Glenn as editor and future Bond director ensuring everything moves at a pace where little time is wasted, this is truly amongst the best 70s spy cinema has to offer. It is pitch perfect tonally, never straying too far into camp as the Moore films often did, whilst maintaining a cheerful sense of humour.
Observe, Mr. Bond, the instruments of Armageddon.
It has a great villain in Stromberg, with an unforgettable henchman in Jaws, and of course Barbara Bach portrays one of the best Bond girls of all time. She is as integral to the plot as Bond, and holds her own against and alongside him throughout, until she is damsel in distress at the very end, but hey, it was the 70s.
You ever get the feeling somebody doesn't like you?
Honestly, very few Bond films gel as well as this. Though of course, that formula was established and perfected quickly with the third Bond film, Goldfinger. The first Bond film from regular director Guy Hamilton, I'm not sure where to begin with Goldfinger. From the cold open, run through of a subtle sense of humour that would become de rigueur for the series, to that incredible theme by Shirley Bassey, Sean Connery on never better form, a villain and henchman combination for the ages, lines that you can just imagine the writers celebrated themselves for putting down to paper.
Man has climbed Mount Everest. Gone to the bottom of the ocean, he has fired rockets to the moon, split the atom, achieved miracles in every field of human endeavor, except crime!
Visuals that are burnt into pop culture beyond the film itself, and a car that has come back time and time again throughout the series, this really is a stunning popcorn film that predates the best of action cinema by almost 20 years. Goldfinger will always remain, in my eyes, not only one of the best Bond films, but one of the most important British films of all time.
We're using this Aston Martin DB5 with modifications. Now, pay attention, please.
This never happened to the other fella.
Now, I probably couldn't have selected a more divisive number one pick. On Her Majesty's Secret Service has since its release been a controversial entry in the series. George Lazenby's performance has drawn criticism, especially in comparison to a role Connery had made his own, and it spends as much time developing Bond's relationship with Diana Riggs Tracy as it does anything nearing action. And that is why I love it.
We need nothing more.
Connery's Bond wouldn't have worked in this film, which required a more disarmed man, one physically capable of action but with his walls down, an image of masculinity masking a real, clear fragility. Lazenby embodied that. Telly Savalas' less cartoonish, more grounded performance as Blofeld provided the exact right villain for this version of Bond 2.
That will remain my secret.
And it's of course a beautiful film, absolutely making the most of its frame and the depth of its world more than most Bond films before and since. And of course, the stunt work and action within that frame is handled with aplomb and still impresses today. Finally though, as I've explored in more detail in a previous video that you can find in the description, this allowed audiences to see Bond differently. Not only in how he was performed, but in what the creators allowed him to do, to experience. He lets himself find love, to get married, to go against everything we expect of him, and finds happiness. And then the villains take it away. In one short, brutal scene, we see Bond as vulnerable, struggling with loss.
It's all right. It's quite all right, really. She's having a rest.
It redefines the character for every Bond film this point on.
We'll be going on soon.
And that is why it is here as number one on my list of the best Bond films. I can't really imagine a world where we don't have a semi-regular flow of James Bond films. Even if we were to get another long hiatus, which I don't see happening for a while based on the box office of the most recent entries, someone would start the cycle again. You can never kill James Bond. He predates the first real action film era and has both defined and learnt from every cycle of thrilling cinema thus far. It's hard to say where the series should go after No Time to Die, when it finally comes out. I think there is always potential to get more films matching the best of Bond, but I'd be surprised if we get any quite as bad as the worst thus seen.
BJ, we have company.
No problem, this is a company car.
I am sure many will disagree with my ordering of the films. Please remember this is a ranking of my favourites, and it is not meant to be a definitive list or anything like that. One thing is for sure, regardless of the quality of each single entry, it is a wonderful way to look at how cinema in general has developed over time.
Age is no guarantee of efficiency.
And youth is no guarantee of innovation.
And without the Bond films, that wider cinema itself would be a far less interesting and entertaining place.
Fill her up, please.
Just to reiterate, this video has been sponsored by Surfshark. Not only is it a very secure service that gives peace of mind around the security of your devices, on which it will cover up to 6 of them, but it's also incredibly easy to use. Of course, my viewers will appreciate too that it gives them the freedom to see content that is not available on their local video services, through bypassing region restrictions in the click of a button. For a limited time, get 83% off a 2-year plan and an additional month for free at surfshark.deals/rossatron and use the code Rossatron. This special offer makes your subscription just $1.91 per month, so you can browse securely on all your devices.